covering a paper which is for the topic called Renaissance to Reformation era. I covered the key aspects of these movements. So the very first thing about the lecture, today's lecture, is about the relevance of the seminar. So the main purpose of this seminar is to contextualize and conceptualize the understanding of the age, which is relevant for the understanding of movements, history, socio-cultural, economic, religious or political background of the age in which the text as well as the author is located. So I'll start my presentation with the introduction of Italian Renaissance, which is already interlinked with Chaucer's era that Archer ma'am has already covered. So you already know the basic background of the Italian Renaissance age. So the Renaissance actually started in Italy in 14th century, and later it got flourished in France, Germany, Russia and other major parts of European continent. So this many-sided movement, as it covered literary history, artistic sensibility, culture, then scientific discoveries, geographical explorations. So this many-sided movement actually originated in 14th century in the domain of art and architecture. So this is the beginning of Italian Renaissance. So this complex movement had its origins in 1348 in Florence. That is the cultural city of Italy, which is known for the natural landscapes, the cultural revolution and the artistic revival. In 14th century, the entire European continent suffered a turbulence in the form of constant wars, plagues, social revolts and the breakdown of feudal categories and the decline of medieval religious hierarchies. So this created a political, economic and religious breakdown of all the established hierarchies which were already present and already very powerful since medieval time period. The arrival of devastating Black Death, which is a major epidemic or the major, you can say, plague, so proved to be a major catalyst for the entire continent. The huge death tolls sparked a chain of events that led to the birth of this vibrant movement called Renaissance. So you can see in this slide that some important and relevant details about the Black Death are given. So Archer ma'am has already covered the background of Black Death, right? So you are already very familiar with the background of the Black Death. Now, one of the major reasons behind the arrival of Renaissance was church's failure and its inability to provide any physical or spiritual relief to the massive large-scale sufferings. As already the details are given that how the entire European continent suffered a lot during the time of Black Death. And one of the factual details is that almost one-third of European continent suffered in the time period of Black Death. So it actually wiped out almost 50% of the European population during 1350s. So it automatically resulted in the breakdown of religious faith and superstitious values which were highly dominant in medieval era. Now the Renaissance movement categorically rejected medieval religious hierarchies, according to which Pope and priest were considered to be the mediator between God and people. Yes, next. This is again about the failure of the church, how church was not able to provide any spiritual relief to the mankind. Next. So, here the major themes of the Renaissance are given. So, I have already informed that Pope and priests were powerful in the medieval time period, but now there was questioning upon the role of these superior religious figures, and it was a questioning upon the entire religious hierarchy. So, most of the religious and scholarly texts during Renaissance period were written in Latin language, resulting in the monopoly of church over religion, over the academics, and over all the domains of the society. But with the development of the Renaissance ideas, the previously established mainstream beliefs were shattered, and people started questioning the concept of afterlife. This shift from afterlife to this earthly life is the major characteristic of the Italian Renaissance. So, the shift from religion and divinity to humanism and sense of individuality is one of the greatest achievements of the Renaissance movement. One of the major guests. Next slide. So, one of the major gifts of this movement is reflected in the usage of the term Renaissance. Let me tell you, this is not an English term, this is actually a French term which means revival or rebirth, though it is a very popular movement in the history of English literature. So, Renaissance term stands for revival or rebirth. But the major question is, it is the revival and rebirth of what? So, it stands for the rebirth of men, rediscovery of humanism values, and finally the revival of classical learning, which got declined during the medieval era. As a term, Renaissance word was first used by Vasari in his famous work called Lives of the Most Excellent Painters, Sculptors and Architects. In fact, Renaissance as a movement itself was limited to the art, architecture and music during its initial phase. As a period, Renaissance existed between medieval to Baroque era. This is the slide. So, you have the paintings which are about the Baroque era. So, the period from medieval to Baroque era is generally categorized as the period from 14th to 17th century. The Baroque was a highly decorated or ornate style that we can see in the paintings itself. So, it was used by the writers and artists of 17th century. Still, it was very popular in 18th century, but the relevance of Baroque got declined in the first half of 19th century. Now we have the origin of the Romanticism movement and its popularity. So, the Baroque was the counter movement which was initiated by Roman Catholics against the simplicity in art and architecture which was initiated by Protestants. So, there was a constant conflict between Protestants and Catholics. Catholics were supporting the ornamental or excessive style in art, whereas the Protestants were advocating the simplicity in art and architecture, mainly the religious architecture. Next slide. So, this uniform movement, when we talk about Renaissance, It is categorized as Italian Renaissance, French Renaissance, English Renaissance, but do remember this is a uniform movement which happened throughout the European continent mainly. So this uniform movement itself was divided into many phases, each phase corresponding to the beginning of new ideas, new values and new beliefs. The initial period, this is the initial period of the Renaissance, was labeled as Proto-Renaissance, which was also called the Pre-Renaissance period. You have a timeline too. The Proto-Renaissance was started in 1300, that is the beginning of 14th century, and it remained till 1400, which is considered to be the death year of Chaucer. After 1400, we have the Baron period in English literature, which is also considered to be the golden age for Scottish literature. So this Proto-Renaissance period was known for the popularity of Gothic writings and Gothic art and architecture. Gothic is a term, I think you are familiar with the Gothicism. It's one of the key aspects of Romanticism era also, right? It refers to the creation of horror, creation of sublime feelings, right? So we have the unusual feelings, right, which are associated with the Gothic style in art and architecture when it happened in Italian Renaissance time period. So this interest in Gothic was again revived during the Romanticism period, that is the later movement. So Gothic again refers to the gloomy order, mysterious setting or the unusual experience which happened or which was witnessed by the Italian artists and painters while they were researching about art and architecture during this time period. After Proto-Renaissance comes the early Renaissance period, which is again very relevant as it covers the entire age, which is starting from 1400 to 1475. So the major portion of the 15th century belongs to the flourishment of Proto-Renaissance movement, that is the second phase. Now Proto-Renaissance movement popularized the fresco form. Fresco is basically the paintings which are painted on the lime wet plaster. So there were new innovations which were started by Italian artists during this time period. So during Proto-Renaissance time period, there was the full growth of art and architecture, which was later continued by the High Renaissance period. So earlier the artists were considered as craftsmen, but art developed in its form with the arrival of major artists and painters during the High Renaissance time period. This is the High Renaissance time period, as it is the time period which is known for the emergence of many popular artists such as Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, Raphael and Sandro Botticelli. The mature phase of Renaissance covered the mannerism style. This is the mannerism style which was sustained from 1525 to 1600. This is the basic timeline of mannerism. Now, mannerism artists employed exaggeration and excessive artistic style along with Gothicism in their art and architecture. The most important aspect of the High Renaissance paintings was the experiment with the perspectives. The artist started focusing upon the human perspective, linear art form, geometrical proportions and the realism, which created a new phase in the Italian Renaissance. This is a famous painting by Leonardo da Vinci called Mona Lisa, right? So, Vinci's masterpiece works such as The Last Supper, Mona Lisa, and The Lady with an Ermine belongs to High Renaissance era. Next. From the same line, Michelangelo's The Last Judgment, painted on the ceilings of Sistine chapels, made Italian art highly popular. You can see this entire decorative art is happening on the ceiling of the chapel. Now, Raphael, the next one. Raphael also painted the School of Athens, which was about the Neoplatonic ideas and knowledge system. Donatello also talked about the emotional aspect of the art, which was completely ignored during the High Renaissance period. And he rejected the linear perspective in art and became the first since antiquity to sculpt a standing nude figure. Now, music form also witnessed a change during Italian Renaissance time period. It meant many radical transformations. Earlier, the music was entirely sacred and purely religious. But with the arrival of Renaissance period, Ars Antica form, which is related to the sacred music, was replaced by Ars Nova. Ars Nova is basically a Latin term which stands for the new art. So, the music became more secular, the new rhyme was introduced during this time period. And it created a radical movement in the form and domain of literature too. Next. Another factor that contributed in the development of Renaissance art was the dominance of Medici family in Florence. So, this is the timeline of Medici family. So, Medicis were the wealthy patrons of art and they were highly active in the Italian politics. So, they invested heavily in the growth of art and architecture, particularly in Florence during this time period. So, there was huge growth of decorative art, church, architecture and paintings during the Medici time period. So, Medici family also contributed. Here it is represented. This is the Plato's Academy. You must be familiar with Plato, Aristotle, right? So, Medici's family contributed in the establishment of Neoplatonic Academy, which is considered to be the greatest achievement of Italian High Renaissance time period. So, the Neoplatonic Academy contributed in the revival of Plato's readings, as the major purpose of this academy was to translate Plato's works into English language. So, the classical antiquity, the classical learning got revived during this time period. So, it is not with the English Renaissance that we have the revival of classical learning that happened in Italian Renaissance period. So, the great Italian humanistic scholar Pico della Mirandola also belongs to this Neoplatonic Academy. His milestone work, that is Oration on the Dignity of Man, created a radical transformation in the domain of literature and society, as it was labeled as Manifesto of Renaissance. This text was labeled as Manifesto of Renaissance. Now, Mirandola talked about the rational capabilities of human intellect. So, earlier, this rationality, the intellectual aspect of human mind was ignored in medieval time period, as the society was entirely religious. But now, he talked about the rational capabilities. That means that the human has the potential to reach to the level of angels, and he or she, they also carry the destructive potential that can lead to the lower categories. So, according to Mirandola, which is also a popular faith of the Renaissance humanist, that here is not any assigned place to humans. It's a great chain of being. So this miraculous faith or this new belief also contributed in the growth of Renaissance period and Renaissance ideas basically. Such humanistic view of Renaissance, why humanism? As now people were focusing upon the concept of humanity, the idea of human potential, they were rejecting the medieval knowledge, the religious dominance. So this humanistic view of Renaissance period challenged the medieval outlook and its strong religious values. In fact, the very idea of Middle Ages was formulated by Italian thinkers who wanted to demarcate or who wanted to distinguish their age from the earlier age, the preceding age, which is Middle Ages. So they gave this term, the Middle Ages, to the earlier establishments and the earlier faith system that we have witnessed in Anglo-Saxon time period and Anglo-Norman time period. So Renaissance as a movement was departure from this medieval faith that happened in 14th century. So these humanistic thinkers advocated the exploration of human potential and the free expression of individualism. Men's constant urge to know more and the quest to know the secret of the universe led to numerous scientific and geographical discoveries, which became the brilliant achievement of Renaissance era. Now, the secular aspect of Renaissance period was influenced by, please go through the slide. The secular aspect, the last one. The secular aspect of Renaissance period was influenced by the views of Greek philosopher Protagoras. There is a quotation who said, man is the measure of all things. The rebirth of men and re-emergence of humanism concept became the key feature of Renaissance era. Apart from Renaissance ideas which are related and interlinked to the rebirth of men, Renaissance also incorporated the revival of classical learning. One of the historical events associated with the revival of classical learning happened in 1453. The 15th century, which is marked for the decline of Eastern Roman Empire. Achimek has already covered how the Western Roman Empire got declined in 5th century. But still, the Roman culture was active in the Eastern Byzantine Empire. Constantinople was considered to be the cultural city of the Byzantine Empire. This is the next slide. So, in 1453, the Eastern Roman Empire met its fall with the invasion of Constantinople city by Turks of Ottoman Empire. So this created a major disruption in the hierarchies as the city was considered to be the capital city of Byzantine Empire and was considered to be the cultural center of Rome. But with the fall of Byzantine Empire, many Greek scholars moved westward with their scholarly texts, mainly the Greek, Roman text and the Latin text, and they took shelter in the other parts of Europe, mainly in Italy. So from here, we have the revival of classical learning, particularly in Italy, which henceforth became the center of humanistic learning. Before such restoration and revival of classical learning, the outlook of literature and life was purely theocratic and purely sacred. We do not have the secular approach to literature and secular approach to society, and the worldly literature was looked down upon as pagan, sensuous, and immoral. But now the entire Italy was flooded with scholarly texts of these writers, and it led to the growth of Renaissance values. It was one of the great achievements of Renaissance era, as whenever Renaissance touched any nation, space, or any writer or any particular period, it led to the growth of culture, artistic sensibility, and literary and intellectual development. The growth of Renaissance learning also resulted in the breakdown of medieval hierarchies, which were highly dominant in Chaucerian era and pre-Chaucerian era, that we do know as medieval era. So the medieval studies now got replaced with the classical text, and there are famous classical texts of Aristotle, Plato, Virgil, Ovid, Seneca, Plutarch. So many writers are there. But Petrarch's rediscovery of Cicero's letters is considered to be the beginning of Renaissance in Italy, as Cicero's letters gave us many traces about the antiquity and the major literary and political happenings of Italian Renaissance time period. In Middle Ages, the scholarship was undertaken by clergymen, monks, and scholars of the cathedral schools. But now, we witnessed the growth of a new secular class which was almost absent in the previous ages. Though Chaucer's work also gave many references to the newly arrived secular class, but it is only during the high period or high Renaissance period that we have the growth of this class. Finally, the monopoly of Latin language was challenged during this time period, as Latin was the language of church, even in ancient time period, medieval time period. So all languages are changing with the arrival of new invaders, with the arrival of new kind of literature, but Latin was there as the permanent language of church and the permanent language of clergymen. So now the dominance of Latin language was undermined. Dante, Petrarch, and Boccaccio, who are considered to be the three major writers of Italian Renaissance, they popularized the vernacular languages, which were not very much popular in the medieval time period. Chaucer also contributed in the growth of vernacular language. So Dante basically wrote the literature in Tuscan dialect, which is the form of a vernacular language. In his landmark work called Divina Commedia, or that is the Italian title, Divina Commedia, or what we say, Divine Comedy. So Dante made a radical experiment with the form of literature, as comedies were seen very vulgar and lower in form during the ancient and medieval time period, and tragedies were considered to be higher in form. But the title Divine Comedy artistically combined the divinity idea with the comic idea, the comedy idea, right? So there is a new experiment, as it promoted the growth of the comedies too. And these comedies became very popular during the Renaissance drama time period. Like Dante, Boccaccio also became a popular Renaissance humanist, who provided brilliant narration of Black Death in his landmark work called The Recovery. But it is Francesco Petrarch, who is generally credited as the founder of Italian Renaissance humanism. He contributed in the development of sonnet form, which was originally initiated in Italy by Lentini. So Petrarch polished their sonnet form, and he also popularized the courtly love tradition, which inspired English Renaissance writers such as Sidney, Spencer, and Shakespeare. According to Neoplatonism and courtly love tradition, the beloved was considered to be the manifestation of heavenly beauty. The beauty of the beloved was considered to be sacred. It was the symbol of idealism, chastity, and purity. So, this idea, which was originally given by Petrarch, became one of the major features of Renaissance poetry. So, the English Renaissance poetry was highly inspired by the Italian literature that we can witness in such references. Apart from Italian humanism, the English Renaissance was also influenced by the radical invention of printing press. This is the invention of printing press which has been highlighted in the slide. So originally the printing press was introduced in 1450s in Germany, but it was only in 1476 that it was introduced into England by William Capstone. So with the arrival of printing press, the entire Europe was flooded with the scholarly text, with the English translations of Bible, and the books became easily accessible to masses. Earlier, the manuscripts were controlled by the religious hierarchies. They were kept in monasteries and the church cathedrals. But now, the common mass witnessed a new kind of change, and they became more educated and more learned with the arrival of these new innovations. So now the knowledge was no longer under the monopoly of the church establishments. Next one after printing press is related to the scientific aspect of Renaissance. That is again the part of English Renaissance. So when we talk about the Italian Renaissance, it is mainly related to art, architecture, and music. But when we do talk about the English Renaissance, major innovations are happening in literary sphere, geographical domains, and scientific aspect of the age. So the scientific aspect of Renaissance made everyday life more secular in its approach. So in medieval time, the approach was entirely religious and sacred. Now it became secular. So this shift from sacred to secular is one of the key aspects of Renaissance as a movement. Copernicus, the founder of modern astronomy, challenged the medieval church claim that Earth is the center of universe. So this was the religious knowledge which was given by Pope, priest, and other figures of church. So in 1507, he explained the solar system and claimed that Earth is just a minor planet in the entire universe, and it is actually the sun which lies at the center of the universe. So after Copernicus, we have Galileo, Kepler, Lord Harvey, who also contributed in the development of scientific aspect of Renaissance. Now Lord Harvey described the scientific working of human body. Earlier, church claimed that man's body is made out of ashes. So this very religious kind of approach towards human body and human life was completely rejected by the new scientist. Another major characteristic of English Renaissance was the growth of Renaissance theater and drama. So the literary form called drama got declined during medieval time period. But the major question is that is it the first time that we have the origin of drama? No. In the classical time period also, drama was important literary form. So many brilliant classical dramatists are there, but the reading and the reading of the classical drama got declined during medieval time period, and in the Renaissance time period we have the revival of the classical drama too, which promoted the growth of Renaissance drama as well as the Renaissance theater. So the ancient writings were basically restricted to pagan notions, the harvesting culture and the spread of fertility ideas, the worshipping of nature. But now we have a major growth in the drama form as it became more secular in its approach. So in medieval time period, the drama was considered to be a sin, as entertainment was considered to be the forbidden sin during according to Pope, priests and religious figures. So though drama was suppressed during medieval time period, but many of it turned into folk plays, thus popularizing the medieval drama cycles. The medieval drama cycles were given, where we have morality plays, mystery plays and miracle plays. So in the beginning phase of 12th century, the church allowed only the liturgical drama to be performed. So liturgical drama is basically the religious drama which was performed within the boundaries of church. Such drama was basically performed within the boundaries or circumference of church according or as per the days, like Easter Day, Corpus Christi Day. So certain religious days were assigned and they covered the entire history from the creation to the fall and last judgment. So temptation scenes are created and many religious active scenes which are there in Old Testament and New Testament are performed by the dramatists. But later on, the liturgical drama got developed into three medieval cycles. The very first is miracle plays. Here we have the categorization to miracle, morality and mystery plays. So miracle plays provided the real and fictional account of saints' lives. So these were purely religiously narrative forms which became popular during the performance of miracle plays. Next one is mystery play. Mystery is not only referring to the mystery idea. Mystery is a term which got developed from a Latin term called mysterium. Mysterium basically refers to the trade. So many guilds or merchants were assigned to performance of such drama. In Chaucer's era, this was considered to be a newly emerged class, the merchant class. So it became highly popular during this time period, and the theatrical performance of drama became the dominant motive of these writers who were performing the drama and the guilds who were sponsoring the drama simultaneously. So they started using stage components to magnify their performances. So when we talk about the liturgical drama or miracle plays, they were very simple. They were actually based upon the narratives. But now we have the theatrical performance of drama, as Renaissance theatre is also known for the brilliant performances. This is a slide referring to Dr. Foster's text by Marlowe. So now stages or fixed structure was used by the miracle plays and mystery play writers, and they used the settings to show the permanent settings like heaven and hell. So you have the permanent settings here, but platea was used. Platea basically refers to plays. So platea was used to perform the moving drama. Another brilliant achievement of this time period was the use of pageant wagons. That is the wooden cardboard with the moving wheels, and that promoted the growth of moving drama, which was performed in the open streets. So drama came in the domain of the public sphere with the arrival of mystery plays. So Four mystery plays are there. Four mystery cycles got evolved out of miracle plays and liturgical drama, and they were named as York plays, Wakefield plays, Chester cycles, and lastly the End Town plays. But the greatest drama cycle, which got developed in the form of morality plays, became popular in late 15th and 16th century. The morality plays are very important, as it created a great impact upon the Renaissance dramatists too. They radically departed from the earlier miracle and mystery cycles. Instead of representing the entire divine life or the entire biblical history, the morality play writers focused upon the individual Christian life, the struggle of the human intellect, and the inner conflicts were the major themes of morality plays. And these are the major themes of Renaissance writers too, who also portrayed such themes in their drama. For example, Marlowe's Dr. Faustus is about such inner conflicts, whether to go for divinity or to adhere to the secular approach, the newly emerged secular approach. So Marlowe's popular play called Dr. Faustus also reveals and dramatized this conflict which was happening between medieval plays and the Renaissance plays, and these two ages too. So Dr. Faustus during 16th century became the epitome of Renaissance men, in whom all the human faculties are harmoniously developed. So whether we talk about the intellectual capabilities, the scholarly achievements, or the social merits, Dr. Faustus became the epitome of all these great achievements. But his urge to know more and to explore the maximum potential led to his downfall. So a moral warning is also created within the boundaries of a Renaissance text. And this is the time period when actually the moral issues were intermingled with the newly emerged Renaissance values. Almost all the major protagonists of Marlowe's plays are talking about particular powers and particular cultivations of Renaissance men. For example, The Jew of Malta, which is a popular play by Marlowe, Christopher Marlowe, represents the power of money. Tamburlaine is representing the power of rule. And finally, Dr. Faustus, which is a landmark work by Christopher Marlowe, displays the power of knowledge. Like Marlowe, other university works also popularized the new genres during Renaissance time period. We have the university wits such as Robert Greene, Thomas Gates, George Peel, Thomas Nash. So they also contributed in the growth of Renaissance drama. With the arrival of these university wits, the drama became more secular in its approach and it became more sophisticated, as they were the writers who were either educated from Oxford and Cambridge University. One of the notable views that Shakespeare, who is considered to be the greatest writer of Renaissance era, was not a university wit at all. Each university wit contributed in the development of a particular genre. For example, Robert Greene popularized the dramatic prose form, Thomas Nash introduced the satire form, and Thomas Kidd introduced the revenge tragedy concept, which got evolved out of Senegal tragedies. Kidd's famous play, and which is the only known play by Kidd, the Spanish tragedy, is considered to be the first revenge tragedy in English Renaissance drama. Whereas Shakespeare's Hamlet is considered to be one of the greatest Renaissance tragedy, which is a revenge tragedy. This is about the theatre, Renaissance theatre. So the construction of Renaissance theatre was started in 1576, also led to the further growth of Renaissance venues in England. The earlier theaters were built in the form of ancient amphitheaters, which are the open theaters, and they were decorated with the Greek and Roman images. So this was a strategic way to legitimize the drama and to legitimize the theater during Renaissance time period. And this opening of theater, which is highly inspired by the architecture of classical theater, marked the renewal of interest in classical drama. So classical texts became very popular during this time period. Apart from artistic, scientific, literary and intellectual developments, Renaissance movement also witnessed a change in the status of faith and religion. Before the arrival of Renaissance period, particularly the Elizabethan era, the students must be familiar with the Elizabethan era that started with the crowning of Queen Elizabeth in 1558. So, before the arrival of Elizabethan era, England went through massive religious and radical transformations such as Lollard movement, Protestant Reformation, the Great Reformation and Marian persecutions. So all these events led to the change in the faith system and the development of new religious hierarchies. Hierarchies, as religion was still dominant and active in the social, cultural, political and economic lives. So, but Queen Elizabeth provided a stability to Renaissance court, Renaissance culture and the religion, as she was a follower of Protestant, but she was still tolerant to Catholic. So the constant clash which was there between Catholics and Protestant, it was not that much intense during the Elizabethan era. One of the first major religious movement against Roman Catholic Church was initiated by John Wycliffe in 14th century. Here we have the references to this contemporary of Chaucer was expelled from Oxford University for his controversial views about Roman Catholic Church and religious faith, and in 1382